for those who don't know, he is the...
I think Mark heard Xbox and Pop wanted to pop in. So Mark Rizzn Hopkins wants to come in and share his opinion. Now, Mark Rizzn Hopkins is our editor. He's a young guy on the team compared to us, but is a resident Xbox and has been following the story around the Xbox. We've had conversations and discussions, debates, but also agreement that Xbox is the preferred user experience for a class of users, like my son, who is a very big Xbox user. So Xbox and the gaming environment and the gamification is ultimately going to be a tactical thing that people are going to be doing in the future, in a work environment, possibly. So share with us your vision on Xbox's relevance to, say, the Skype announcement.
For quite some time that the Xbox could be kind of central to the like the living room experience in a way more than just what console gaming will provide. But in it seems like when with the release of the Kinect is when Microsoft really got that vision. Because right around the same time they released the Kinect, they also released put prominently like ESPN, live sports. They also just recently put Hulu Plus on there. They already had Netflix. So most of what they call cord cutters could want from a home entertainment experience is now available on this Xbox. And it's become more of a, with Kinect, they also got live interaction.
Cord cutters being untethered users.
Untethered, you know, cable or telco entertainment users. Right, exactly. And so similar to that, they were also trying to integrate the Xbox with the Microsoft Live experience, which is, you know, of course, MSN Messenger and all the unified login that Microsoft has across all of their sites and properties. The Skype acquisition is exciting to me because you can see, you know, something that has massive adoption like Skype for a communications tool taking the place of that live, that whole live connecting thread that they have. Skype on the Xbox, making that your communications tool not just with other gamers, but actual people that, you
well,
know,
Gordon Bing, who's a partner at Kleiner Perkins with John Doerr, are putting, you know, $500 million on the social fund, and he used to be the CEO of EA Gaming, and he says, because they're also an investor in Zynga, he says that the folks out there who are gamers are probably the most prolific doctors and or workers in corporate America, because the work environment from a collaboration standpoint will look like multiplayer online gaming. Exactly. So there's a headset, there's communications involved, there's a little bit of operational, you know, teamwork. And so in a virtual setting, I mean, I think Xbox truly emulates, in my opinion, what the future work environment will look like. So, and that is, gamers will be the most prolific, productive resources in society.
We're talking about Microsoft. The big deal that was just recently announced late last night was Microsoft buying Skype for $8.5 billion. I'm not sure if that includes the $600 million of debt, but still, Microsoft's largest acquisition ever. We're talking to Mark Rizzn Hopkins. I'm here with John Furrier, both of SiliconANGLE. Let's break this down for people. So that was what it was announced. They're buying it from Silver Lake and Andreessen Horowitz, who makes them make a tidy profit on this deal. Those guys bought it from eBay a while back and making some nice cabbage on that. Why
fast, Mark, too? They made a fast turnaround of their investment, and I believe they were under a lot of pressure to sell that. I'm going to dig into that when I get home into Palo Alto. I think they're under a lot of pressure to deliver results.
So why is Microsoft, let's start with John. John, why is Microsoft making this move, in your opinion?
I think Microsoft is irrelevant to the outside world of a new generation of workers. I mean, EMC's theme of cloud meets big data is about a new future direction. Hadoop speaks to a new strategy of a futuristic society where big data and new value propositions are going to be emerging. Chuck Hollis talked about that, hit the blogger at EMC. Microsoft has just been sideways. They've got this huge franchise of business. They make billions of dollars, yet they got these pockets of innovation like Xbox. They got a great R&D. And really, Microsoft, since the Justice Department put the handcuffs on them when Bill Gates was at the helm after they destroyed Netscape, the browser wars, really haven't done anything. And so Ballmer has been trying to move the battleship around, and ultimately they're losing on every front. So I think what I see with Microsoft is a unification of failed strategies. unified communications, voice over IP, the phone service, the phone that they had, the KIN and other Windows phones. So I think Microsoft's kind of regrouping. It's a positive signal, in my opinion, that they're unifying it. I think Xbox is a shining star in Microsoft, that they could weave that in there. I think it ties together voice over IP.
How about that, Mark Hopkins?
I don't disagree as much as I like to, because Microsoft is one of those companies that I want to love and I want to evangelize and champion, because I'm such a fan of the Xbox and what I think the potential is there. But, you know, Stephen Hodson, Kit Dotson over at SiliconANGLE, working with us on the editorial, primarily the ones on the Microsoft beat, and they will readily, and they're Microsoft fans, and they will readily agree that, yeah, Microsoft doesn't have it together, and it's very difficult to defend Microsoft at times. However, they do have lightning in a bottle if they can just get, you know, coordination.
Expand on that lightning in a bottle. Be specific.
Well, I mean, let me give you an example. I was talking
Spit
on Twitter last night. So, you know, just kind of going with all the usual suspects on Twitter about the news, about Microsoft. Everyone's talking about how Microsoft is going to screw this up, because that's all they know about Microsoft, is how they've always, you know, tended to fail in spite of themselves. And I'm like, hey, doesn't Skype on the Xbox excite anybody? And they're like, yeah, but Xbox, not really Microsoft. I'm like, are you kidding me? You know, okay, people don't identify the
Microsoft
success of the Xbox
Microsoft
with Microsoft.
Microsoft was the Google of its day, and they've hired smart people. And they've always hired great computer scientists. And back in the day, software developers all went to Microsoft. This was before open source really took hold. And if you had any chops in computer science, you went to Microsoft. Now, what's different about Microsoft now and then is that Microsoft would come into a market and launch a version 1, and it always sucked. Okay, but their role was, by the third release, it was market dominating. And that goes back to the DOS roots.
And the Windows.
But ever since Bill Gates lost the DOJ case, or when the government, the U.S. government, went after Microsoft, they've not been the same. They've been gun-shy, almost be decentralized. They really haven't done anything big and powerful and game-changing. Now, they're making billions of dollars. A great enterprise franchise.
Okay, but let's break down the strategy. So we all agree, I think, that Microsoft hasn't had a lot of wins and home runs in terms of innovation, but they're obviously a for-profit company. They're doing this for a reason of you know, competing, getting into a new market. Mark, you're saying they're doing this to basically super glue Skype to Xbox as the primary platform.
And what does
that do for their business? Talk about that.
And I think it also plays into the Windows 7, Windows Phone 7 thing as well.
Right.
Because right when they announced Windows Phone 7, they were very adamant about showcasing the integration with Xbox Live. You know, this is a phone for gamers. And now Nokia, which is a, on the decline, but still a powerhouse in the phone world, not necessarily the smartphone world, but definitely the phone world. They are going to have a good platform to deploy Skype across a wide swath of devices. Windows Phone 7 still has a great potential for success, because it's always got great reviews, just not great adoption.
So, what about the competitive landscape? Obviously, Google.
Right.
Right.
Competitive landscape, yeah.
Telcos a competitor in this equation? I mean, is Microsoft a threat
levels,
to telcos?
On certain levels. It would be a threat to telcos. I mean, I see a lot of conflict between Microsoft and the telcos about getting Skype on the phones, because that's always the stumbling block for Skype. Skype always puts restrictions on most of the carriers about letting VoIP traffic travel across their data networks.
Right.
I don't see that changing anytime real soon, even with Microsoft's pressure. Especially because they don't have a lot of leverage. You know, they're not the dominant, smartphone manufacturer.
So it's really more about enriching the Microsoft platform, be it the Windows 7 platform, and new emerging consumer devices like Xbox, and providing that VoIP capability for communicating new channel of communications for Microsoft that's embedded, right?
And Skype has actually probably almost as much leverage as Microsoft in that space, because I know just from our conversations with Skype that they've been pushing really hard with carriers just to, free up, allow us, like on the iPhone or on other Android devices, let us do our Skype thing. Your users will love you for it. So maybe they'll be able to pull something off, but I think Skype can be a great unifying thread between all the places where Microsoft is.
So John Furrier, you were making the point that Microsoft, back in the days of antitrust litigation, became a little more shy about going hard after the, for instance, bundling. This is a presumably clearly a bundling strategy. Microsoft doesn't have the handcuffs on it as it used to from the DOJ. So is that we're seeing a recast of the old Microsoft playbook, and will it work?
Well, I think Microsoft. Well, first of all, I think that was one factor going into the Microsoft kind of flattening out, in my opinion. But a lot of other factors have come into play too. Like, for example, Microsoft beat the hell out of Sun Microsystems, which went proprietary with their servers, right? So back in the day, you had Sun as a server vendor, even HP, but for the most part, HP was partnered with Microsoft. Open source really took hold. So, I mean, Microsoft was a software company, and, you know, as an ex-computer science major, ex-software guy myself, the joke was they don't really write good code. So, you know, the open source movement became a different paradigm than Microsoft. So you were either on the open source software Unix movement, or you were on the Microsoft camp.
Right.
Both had robust ecosystems. So the combination of the DOJ handcuffing of Microsoft plus the rise of open source kind of stagnated Microsoft. So what that did was, then Gates retired, but they're making billions of dollars. It became this massive company. And they weren't evil anymore. They were just kind of wimps. So what happened then was Google came along, the internet came along and expanded. So that after the dot-com bubble, new stuff started happening, and Microsoft has been groping ever since.
Mark Hopkins, thanks for coming on. Appreciate your insights. Thank you for breaking it down. It's an interesting discussion, John. I mean, I'm still a little fuzzy on what the objectives are for the Microsoft acquisition. Clearly, the cool factor. Right? Clearly, I think to add value to the platform. But there's got to be more than that.
Well, let me try to break down the acquisition in my opinion. The way I see it is that Skype came from eBay. They had two main markets, okay, that Skype had. They had great P2P technology. Well, let's just start with, they had massive user base. They had 800 million registered users. The 800 million registered users were averaging about 50 million plus a day simultaneously at any given time. If you think about that, that's bigger than Facebook. So I wrote a post about that. So, you know, 800 million registered users is bigger than Facebook. And Facebook's valuations, look at that valuation, $50 billion. So the second thing is that Skype was a new company formed out of eBay, so it was growing at a huge rate. And that growth rate was just so massive. And on the international side, they were winning voice business in emerging countries. And the third thing is, they had a massive video opportunity. So all those things come together. Skype was just growing too fast, too big of an asset, and I think Microsoft was really smart by picking them up. Question from Michael Sean Wright, our creative director. The role of Jeremy Burton, the CMO of EMC, playing in the EMC event here. I think Jeremy Burton played a very big role in this event, in the sense that EMC